revenge dramas are some of the oldest stories we have, you know, as a species. You know, if you go back to its ancient Greek tragedy and earlier. And I think always with those stories, they involve this idea of the circularity of revenge, the idea that it becomes this self-perpetuating cycle.
I promised her that I was going to get them. If it's the last thing I do, I'm going to get them. They're going to pay.
The movie really began as a no-budget film, and for much of the span of its run, we had no money. And so there really wasn't even pitching for almost probably, you know, it was like the first six or seven years of the project. I think it really helped us because it was done in a really exploratory way. We didn't know what we were looking for exactly. We didn't know how deep the story ran. When it did come time to pitch it, we knew that we had this incredible hook, which is the kind of the MySpace catfishing angle. But kind of equally important was also this idea that it might be a story that begins in some ways as a conventional true crime story, and that hopefully ultimately asks broader questions about the criminal justice system, about empathy, about how one deals with grief, and also how this single event might reverberate through an entire community and might really affect a whole group of people.
My daughter Crystal and my son Justin get right up here. I look over, I see the gun.
Bang, bang, bang.
They said, Crystal's been shot.
It takes a long time to process these things and ultimately you never are done processing a trauma. Time was our friend in that we saw Belinda really in her own way, struggling and thinking about some of these issues. And she continued to change, and her opinions changed as we were talking to her through time. There were revelations and things that we learned that only came, you know, 2 years into filming. And, you know, and I had known her for years before we even started filming. And it's just this process of building up trust and also having an ongoing conversation and revisiting things and thinking about them again. And, you know, that was really, really special. And I think it's only because it was, like I said, it was a kind of no budget movie that had no timeline that we were able to do that. True crime, very typically recreations play a kind of central role in the storytelling. I think that was just something that I've always been bothered by, or I think I've seen enough of it, and I was always interested in trying something new. In the course of an interview with Belinda, at one point she said, "When I think about that night, I see it from above." And that line always stuck with me. And I think one day I was walking into a Ralph's in Culver City or something, and I just thought, oh, wouldn't it be interesting if we kind of tried to literalize this idea from Belinda that when she sees that night, she sees it from above. By having Belinda kind of stand over the miniature and manipulate it, it was this, a little bit of foreshadowing of what she might be up to later in the film, but also this representation of these events as, like I said, taking place somewhere in a space between memory and a nightmare.
Said, how do you do it? I said, I can do it all. Don't worry.
You often think on the internet, nothing ever goes away. But in fact, the opposite is true. Things are disappearing all the time. And MySpace is a great example. I don't know exactly when it was, but they did a grand cleanup and clear up of all of the past messages. And so those were not available to us. And so instead we had to reconstruct them. And we did it primarily through interviews. We did interviews with Belinda and Jamie. We did an interview with them together that was largely focused on what can you remember and what can you tell us about the kind of the texture of those conversations. In our case, we had to go back and do a little bit of kind of almost archaeology, digital archaeology, and try to find as many references as we could to MySpace in 2006. And of course, even then it was a website that was changing constantly. And very quickly, I think we realized that we were never going to be able to get it 100% right. And the goal was much more so to convey some sense of what it looked and felt like and what the internet felt like at that period, which is really a key facilitator in the whole story. That was a period where social media was so new. The norms and rules, I think, that we now understand that govern the way we interact with people on the internet were not so sharply defined. The movie Catfishing hadn't even come out yet. It was still years away from coming out. In some ways, the film represents this intersection of some ideas that are very, very, that are ancient. Ideas of kind of revenge and justice and what you do when you feel wronged. And they're being played out through this kind of, at that time, unique digital contemporary technology. This idea that members of a gang are inherently not part of a community, is itself, of course, a total fallacy. It's like, these are all kids who are from this community. Everyone in this, most of the main characters in this movie are from the same part of Riverside. And I think one of our hopes was that we might show the ways in which they are connected, or some of their own life struggles and circumstances have certain similarities. It's not to say that they're exactly the same, but they have certain similarities. And I think part of Belinda's emotional journey is a journey towards empathy, or at least a kind of a struggle with empathy and how much she might empathize with the members of the gang. It's been an incredible journey. It was a movie that was begun in the humblest possible fashion, and now it has kind of ended as a Netflix original, which is a totally mind-blowing thing unto itself. Started making this film because I thought this was an absolutely incredible story, and I thought the characters were amazing. And so it gives me happiness to be able to know that we have brought their stories to a larger audience. Did we do it all? Did we do it right? I think I will probably fret endlessly about questions of balance in the story and what we included and what we didn't. But at some point, I think I'll have to realize that it's done and it's out. I think hopefully the film, it does tackle this question of why. I know that the title, Why Did You Kill Me, it's a rather aggressive one, but hopefully we do try to get at some of these broader social questions of why. I don't think we do it in the conventional sense of having experts or sociologists tell us what might be the social conditions that might lead to the creation of a gang, or what might be the kind of the universal experience that is represented in various characters in the film. I think we hope that by letting some of these characters speak and tell us their own stories, we can kind of sit with them and get a sense from them of what might be some of these kind of broader social conditions that lead to these types of stories.